So what were you doing pre-COVID then?
Yeah, so I mean, really, it was for us, it was all about teacher training and recruitment. So, we were kind of working with placing teachers all over the world, a lot of teachers into Asia, places like China, South Korea, Japan. And we were doing a lot of training in class and online. So, it was definitely quite a broad spectrum of activities that we were doing. And it was all really, doing really well, very international focused. And then obviously COVID came along and really changed the whole landscape. So it was obviously a massive challenge for us, which is obviously still going on a lot longer than we expected. But yeah, I mean, how about yourself? What was your focus pre-COVID?
Exactly the same as you, really. For what, 15 years, we've focused on sending teachers all around the world, so international schools, language schools, universities, colleges, and then all of a sudden, it just stopped. So pre-COVID, we were sending people on airplanes around the world, and we all know what happened in March 2020. That ended. So for us, we had to change. So talk me through. So March 2020, when we're all told we have to go home, so how did that affect your business then?
Yeah, so I mean, it was obviously quite a shock to start with. So it was basically we realized that we were going to have to change, as you said, our whole kind of business model from international. With the borders closing, teachers just obviously weren't able to physically get on a plane and go and to their job in China or wherever they were supposed to be going to teach. So yeah, we had to kind of think about it. It took us a few months really just to get to grips with the situation, and look to the future and what we could do to kind of get through this period, however long it was going to last, because obviously it was difficult to tell at the time. So we really focused on trying to, which I think obviously it was the same with a lot of companies, you just bring the whole learning experience, the whole teaching experience, bring everything online. And it was time to start finding more online partners, and figure out ways that we could put our training into an online environment, really, which I think is probably the same with a lot of companies. I'm presuming the same for you, was it? How did you kind of adapt initially after that shock of March 2020?
And I think that's the right word, Bill. Shock. So for I mean for us, so I remember it in so February 2020, it was the BSME conference in Abu Dhabi. So that was the last overseas trip that I've done. So we got on the plane, went to Abu Dhabi for the conference, and within 24 hours, the conference had been cancelled, and unfortunately, the hotel was in lockdown. So now stuck in the hotel room in Abu Dhabi at a conference that hasn't taken place, can't even then think, you know what, I'll have a few days in the sun because we're not allowed to leave the hotel room. So basically, 3 days trying to do work sitting on a hotel balcony, wondering what on earth is going on. Because then COVID-19 and all this was so new, no, we had no idea what was going on. So when we were allowed out of the hotel, 4 or 5 days later, came back home to be told by the government that we all had to go and work from home. I'm thinking, what on earth is I've never worked from home in my life. We've just taken on new members of staff, and they're going, we've only just arrived. We're not going to have to go. What are we doing? So then we thought, thinking, oh, we need to do something here because if people can't go anywhere, we've got a problem because that's the bedrock of our business is people traveling all overseas.
Absolutely.
So there was huge, huge panic stations because we're thinking, right, how much have we got in the bank? How much have we got in the savings? How long can we last? How long is this going to go on for? And because everything was so up in the air, we had to make decisions there and then. So exactly like you said, we just had to go, right, let's go online. So we went hell for leather doing business development, looking for online teaching companies where we could send teachers to. So we thought, right, let's focus on that. So we did that for, I don't know, 3, 4 months, interspersed with setting up offices on dining room tables like we've all done and all these
Yes,
things. And,
absolutely. Yeah.
And I don't know about you, but I've never worked from home. And I was absolutely terrified of working from home because I exist in an office environment. I'm thinking, if I work from home, you know what can happen? I'll do the washing, I'll do this, I'll do this. I won't actually do any work. I didn't know what I was going to do. So, and it was that weird thing that you've seen the Hollywood films, the bloke, you know, the person picks up the box and they leave the big corporate office and they walk to the... That's how I felt. I was like, I'm actually sacking myself from my own company. That's how I felt walking out.
Yeah, absolutely. Box. Yeah, that's the thing.
It's so surreal.
Yeah, onto the kitchen table with the kids running around. Yeah, and yeah, absolutely. So it's a massive challenge. Just even adapting to that, isn't it? Just working from home environment, getting out of the office. It's quite alien, isn't it? Once you've spent your 20 odd years working from an office, it's completely new environment to get used to, as well as trying to redirect your whole business model. So it's definitely been challenging, but I guess it's something that that you can definitely grow from as a business. If you can get through something like this, then it's going to stand you in good stead, isn't it, for the future? And you would hope that you wouldn't get this type of thing again, within anytime soon. So I think just to kind of get to the point that we've got and change things and obviously keep going is great, really. And it's something that we can be pretty proud of, I think.
So from your perspective, so March 2020 you had to change your business. Now we're in July 2021. So what have you had to do and what have you done in that time so that you've been able to survive?
I think it's just putting things online, really, that we might not have considered doing in the past, but I think it's worked quite well, and I think people have been quite quick to kind of get into the online ethos and the online way of working, virtual teaching, virtual training, virtual meetings, and it's just something that people have taken to quite quickly, and we've done a lot of focus on recruiting teachers for online roles, and obviously everybody's been stuck at home anyway, so it's been an opportunity to do something from home and work with people in different countries, but just a different way of doing it. So we've just looked to bring everything into that kind of online focus, with the training as well, offering people the option to do their teaching practicum online instead of going to schools, because obviously the schools have all been closed anyway. And I think for the future, it's something that we'll probably keep in place, and I think it's only going to get more. I mean, the trends that we're seeing is that a lot of the schools in different parts of the world, they are looking really for online training now rather than in-class teaching. I mean, let's hope that the in-class model does come back, and I'm presuming it will do, although we're not sure when, but I think until that comes along, people seem to be fairly keen to embrace the online side of things, and luckily it's been really successful. In terms of partnerships and getting things, new directions and, getting on board with new companies. So how's that been for you over the last year? What kind of new partnerships have you established, and how's it all been going for you?
Well, I mean, for us, we moved all online as well. So because we couldn't go anywhere, we couldn't go to trade events and all these sorts of things. We had to look at new partnerships and look at new opportunities. So one of them, as we both know, is with us. So our first partnership throughout this entire pandemic was we started looking at, okay, if we're sending teachers overseas, sorry, online to work for, overseas online companies, they're going to need a teaching qualification. This company is going to provide them with a teaching qualification. So why can't we provide that teaching qualification? So that's when we started looking into the market,
right?
And said, right, okay, I want to work with a well-established, very reputable organisation that delivers TEFL courses. So we looked around, and lo and behold, we found you. And 18 months later, we're still here, which is why the whole topic of this is, two blokes from the north having a chat who would never, ever, ever probably have met if it wouldn't have been
this is it.
Pandemic. And look at what we're doing now. So for me, it's been absolutely brilliant in setting up this partnership. But then on top of that, when we launched our online tutoring business, we created new partnerships to allow us to deliver online tutoring across the world. So we've got now partners in Asia, we've got partners in Europe, we are looking at partners in Latin America, looking at partners in Africa, because we didn't want to just do our online tutoring and keep it exclusive to the UK. We wanted to broadcast, we're an international company. You know, we want to be able to teach children across the globe.
Yeah.
And so that's worked. So we are now delivering tutoring through our own network of teachers across all subjects, all key stages, and it's going extremely well. Then when we set up our digital English language courses, again, we had to look at partnerships because I couldn't physically go to a country and meet partners and resellers and agents. We're thinking, right, okay, this is all very alien because I'm used to getting on a plane and going somewhere, yeah, shaking hands and, you know, whites of the eyes and all the cultural things that we all have to do. So we had to look at online conferences and adapt the way that we sell.
Right.
So that you still get over exactly what you're looking to achieve, but within a virtual environment. So for our English language courses, again, we've now created partnerships in Africa. We've got really, really, really good partners in West Africa and East Africa, which is just fantastic. We're talking to organisations in Latin America. We're talking to organisations in Asia. And if someone would have said to me 18 months ago, this is where your business is going to be, I'd have laughed at them and said, don't be so ridiculous. Why would, you know, this is never going to happen. But now, you know, as you alluded to as well, you have to seize the opportunities that are in front of you.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, this has been born out of extremely tragic circumstances. And I'm not belittling that at all. But
yeah,
as business owners, we have two choices. You either fight or you flight. And I made the decision that there's no way on this earth we're going to give up 15 years of hard work and all the awards that we've won, oh, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. We're going to have to get through this and we're going to have to push through this. And by doing that, we've created new business streams, new partnerships, like with you. As you know, we're doing other things together now in the university space, which is just wonderful. None of that would have occurred if we wouldn't have been thrust into a situation that none of us wanted, none of us expected. But we have to do something about it. I mean, is that the same for you? You know?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I mean, you know, that's the thing. It's our kind of business model really was training people and then getting them jobs overseas. And obviously when that whole route to employment is kind of shut down, then obviously you're going to have to do something quite dramatic to keep going, because you can't lose all of that, you know, that kind of aspect of the business. So yeah, again, I think probably one of the key things has just been new partnerships, getting those established and you know, just getting new routes into employment for our graduates, and just trying to be adaptable and ready to change when we've needed to. So it's you know, it's obviously it's been a very, very challenging process, but I think, as you mentioned before, you know, to kind of get through the 18 months and see, you know, to know that we've got where we've got and we've got all these new partnerships coming on stream. It's been fantastic, really, to see those new areas opening up, those new opportunities opening up for our, you know, for our team and for our students and for our teachers. So, so yeah, you know, I think it's been a challenge, but I think it's been we've got where we've got. And hopefully we might start seeing some you know, kind of reversions back to the in-class teaching coming soon. So we're keeping fingers crossed.
No, good. Well, we're the same as well. You know, we are seeing the green shoots. We are seeing, you know, we are mobilising teachers, not as many as before, but there are still teachers going overseas. There are still teachers looking for roles, you know, and however, what we don't want to do is revert all the way back to what we were doing pre-pandemic.
Yeah.
What we need to look at is say, right, okay, we've now got more business revenue streams, more business opportunities. Let's embrace them all. Now, we shouldn't waste all the hard work and all the stress and the challenges and the effort and the successes that we've been able to achieve in the last 18 months and go, right, that's done. Let's just revert back.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. You need to be, you know, to put all this to use, don't you, and kind of take it forward and you know, be open to new opportunities, new ways of working. So with that said, what's next then for M2R? You know, what's in the pipeline? I know it's a difficult question to ask, but you know, where do you see it kind of heading over the next few years?
Well, I think for us, we've now got the recruitment business, which used to be that used to be all we used to do, but now we've got the recruitment business. We've got our online recruitment business, which is now completely separate. We do our tutoring. We've got our online English language courses. And then we're now offering, through you, the TEFL courses as well. So for us, it's about growing those new businesses, consolidating also the recruitment side, making sure that we're not just self-reliant now on one revenue stream.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that, for me, is one of the takeaways from this. Is, you know, it's the, you know, the old cliche, you know, all your eggs are in one basket. Well, now we've got lots of baskets and lots of eggs, and it makes me feel a lot safer.
Yeah,
because if one of those, if anything happens again, you know, and you know, let's pray that it doesn't, at least we've got other opportunities. So for us, you know, what's next is I'm just going to keep growing the new revenue streams, because people now are more confident with teaching and learning online. As you mentioned, whether that goes back to a full classroom approach, which I know is the aim, and a lot of countries are already moving back to that, whether it's blended or whether it's still purely online, because who knows what's around the corner? We don't know. So it's about being flexible as an organisation. And as a small business, we have that ability. And because we're working in a vibrant sector, you know, education is not going to go away. People have just had to find new ways of educating themselves and others. And by using education technology through apps and online and all these things, and, you know, synchronous and asynchronous learning, et cetera, we're just going to keep driving and pushing forward along that line. I mean, are you the same?
Yeah, absolutely. So I think, again, it's been time for us to reflect, time for us to rebuild and, you know, just repurpose a lot of the things that we do. So in terms of courses and things, we've been spending time developing new courses, just changing content and looking at new solutions, really, for learning that we can offer to international partners and clients. So we've spent the time just to get things, as you said, you know, to try and get some more baskets to put the eggs in, and just, you know, just have a few more of a diverse, you know, revenue streams and opportunities. So yeah, it's definitely been about that, and it's been about consolidating and changing things for the better, really, and just getting new things that we can offer as off the shelf products going forward, and obviously targeting new partners as well through a lot of virtual meetings, a lot of Zoom, a lot of Microsoft Teams and all the rest of it, which I think people have just completely got used to now. And saved a lot of time traveling as well, so you know, there's definitely been a lot to do, but I think it's been quite a beneficial experience in terms of, you know, changing the work environment and just getting new ideas together, really.
Well, this is it. I mean, I feel that because we've not been able to go anywhere and everything's gone online, the ability to have more meetings during the day has grown. So I feel that the last 18 months, we've probably been busier than the previous 18 months. Yeah, okay, yeah. Setting up new businesses and all the rest of it. But, you know, a virtual mission in the morning to India, a virtual conference in the afternoon to Russia, the next day you're doing a virtual mission to China. In a typical working year, there is no way you'll be able to fit on and afford it, let's be honest.
Yeah.
But this way, we can get access to so many new organisations, so many more people. And yeah, there's nothing better than actually sitting in a room. But if you look at it from a travel cost perspective, especially from a small business that, like you, in the last 18 months, we've been hit by not having the revenue because people are going overseas.
Yeah.
Being able to still do business development, as long as you've got the motivation and the enthusiasm to do it, because it can be quite, it is very difficult because you're doing it essentially on your own. Because you're in an office on your own, you're not in front of somebody.
Yeah. That's it. Sometimes, you know, it can be, it can feel quite isolating and quite disorientating, can't it? You know, sometimes when you're just kind of working through your laptop and you don't get that interaction with people, because I guess you don't always get that reassurance from potential new clients about, you know, whether or not you're on the same page. It can be a little bit choppy when you're on a Zoom call. So it's you're not always 100% sure about the information and things. But again, you know, it's something that we've had to get used to. And like you said, it definitely has given a lot more opportunities to meet a lot more people than would have been possible if it was just physical meetings and flying to different parts of the world. And, you know, spending a week out of your year just traveling to different places and things. So it's been, you know, it's kind of accelerated progress in a lot of ways, I think, as you mentioned before.
So before we wrap up, is there anything that you'd have done differently?
That's a very, very good question to finish on, actually. You stumped me there. I think really one thing is definitely plan for the worst case scenario, which when all this started, we were kind of we thought, you know, like probably a lot of people, that it was going to be over by July or summer of last year. We definitely didn't think we'd still be kind of waiting to get people on planes to different countries 18 months later. So I think one thing what's probably worth doing if and obviously, you know, God forbid it does, but if something like this happens again, is just plan for the very worst case and, you know, and then try and work your way forward from there, really, so that you've got contingencies in place. And, you know, I think as well, probably once the pandemic started, maybe looking for opportunities straight away, new opportunities, and just hunker down and just try and get straight into, you know, getting new partners and new clients straight off. I think, you know, we kind of waited a little bit because we thought, well, how long is this going to last? Is it going to be a month? Is it going to be 2 months? And here we are, you know, quite a long time later on. So probably we may have gone a little bit faster into trying to develop new kind of partnerships once the first lockdown came along. But other than that, you know, I think it's just a case of feeling your way through it, and you've got to be adaptable. You've got to be ready for anything, really, ready for the challenges. So how about with you? And stay positive, I guess, as well. You know, keep positive the whole time, you know, and try and, you know, obviously everything's an opportunity, and you've got to see it like that and try things out. And if it doesn't work, it doesn't work. But, you know, at least you've given it a try. So would you share any of those sentiments, Munir, or what's your...
Well, would I have done anything different? I mean, I asked you the question and I'm thinking I don't actually know the answer myself. I mean, for us, I don't actually think we would, because everything's gone in an ordered fashion. So we moved from placing people overseas to placing them online. Then thinking, okay, what loopholes can we close? Right, they need a teaching qualification. Like, can we get them? Yes, we can. Like, so let's bring in a TEFL company, i.e. your company. Then it was a case of, okay, why can't we do this ourselves? Let's set up an online tutoring company. Right, because we need to help all these children all over the world. Right, hang on a minute. What about adults who want to learn English language? We're experts in English language teaching as well. We've done it for years. Let's set up our own English language teaching company and provide teaching, you know, online teaching for adults in English. What about those who want to do self-study, who want to learn from home? Okay, let's do that. So there's been a process all the way through. Would I have done any of that differently? No, I don't actually think I would have done. I'd have still panicked just as much. I would have still worried just as much, because it was stepping into the unknown.
Yeah.
You know, and I think now, 18 months later, you know, both of us, upon reflection, I think we should be quite proud of what we've achieved. And I don't think that we're alone in that.
Absolutely. Yeah, no, that's it. I think it's been a very difficult time for a lot of businesses, unless you're, you know, selling hand sanitizer, I guess, where it's probably been quite. Yeah. So, you know, again, I think it's definitely, you know, we're so pleased to have found really great partnerships. And obviously you're definitely one of those great partnerships and one of the great things that have come out of this experience, really. So, we're grateful for all of your support. And you know, so hopefully we'll be working together for a long time, and we'll kind of you know, get back to a little bit to what we knew before, but in different ways as well.
Well, this is it. Well, I can tell you what, I'll let you go and create more partnerships. I'll go and do mine, and we'll try and do a really cheesy virtual handshake. If I go like that.
There you go.
There you are. Right. Take care.
Great to chat to you. Thank you. Cheers.
See you later, Phil. Cheers.
Yeah, bye.
Okay. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.